Of course, what does that mean if a man's going to come in your house and get your grocery list? That the houses were not locked. Everybody was honest and everything was open. And I remember people talking about they didn't lock their homes up until, I don't know, not too many years ago, because it was just something that everybody respected everybody else's property. I remember that Dr. Kelly Smith did take care of my granddaddy Matthews on my father's side. And he would go to my granddaddy's house, and sometimes I would be there playing, and he would go back and check him out, check his heart and everything, and adjust his medication if he needed that. And then he would always sit down and play a game of dominoes with him. It was something that I thought was so unique, and the doctor, a busy doctor, a very important man, would take the time to sit down and play dominoes. Do you all know what dominoes are? And they still play in the little community center in Bemis. Some of the retired employees from the mill still meet there and play dominoes at the community center today. The cloth that was made in the mill, domestic cloth, was inspected under very, very bright lights, where men would stand there at the big tables and would check the cloth to make sure that it was woven correctly. And if they saw imperfections, they would pull it out at that time. At the noon hour, every day, 7 days a week, the 12 o'clock whistle would blow. It was a whistle, and you could hear it all over the town of Bemis. So you would know to stop. It's time for lunch. The people in the mill would stop all the machinery. Everything would come to a dead halt. And they would, a lot of them, bring their lunches in the little metal lunch boxes. And a lot of them, though, would go home because their home was right there across the street, practically. So some would eat there, and some would go home and for just a short period of time, and then they would go back to the mill. At 9 o'clock at night, the whistle blew again. The whistle blew two times a day, at noon and at 9 p.m. At that time, it meant all you children better be inside. Wouldn't that be great? All the kids are in the house at 9 o'clock. You stopped playing outside and went inside and got ready for bed. My great-grandfather had a pocket watch, my mother said, and every time the whistle blew, he would take it out to see if he was on time, and she said he never was. He was always a minute or two behind. In this model town of Bemis, there was a grocery store, a barber shop, because at one time, men didn't go to a beauty shop to get their hair trimmed. But they went to a barber shop that was run by a man, and they had a barber shop, they had a beauty shop, they had a drug store, a general store, a post office, a park, and later on a fire truck, but not at the very beginning, Mother said. That was added later. So all of this in this little town, because Mr. Bemis wanted to have a model town all contained right in one area, right in one community. There was a movie theater, and I remember going to the movie theater to watch a movie. It was 5 cents. To go see the movie at one point. Now, if you go by, which is the museum now, if you go by, and you will see that most of the houses at one time, they were all painted white. Nobody had any other color on their home but white. And but the movie theater was a pale pink, and they have moved that back to the original color. And somebody said, "Why is it pink?" We don't know, but it was that color originally, so it's now back to that color. I want to talk about the park just a little bit, because that was one of my favorite places to go growing up as a little girl. In the summer when school was out, I would beg my mother to let me go to the park. And there was a lady named Stella Duncan, Miss Stella, and she ran the park. And she had a strong hand, but she was the sweetest, most kind, patient lady I think I've ever known. And she would stand for hours. She would tie a jump rope on one end of a monkey bar or something, and she would throw that rope. I mean, it was just completely dirt, no grass there, and kids jumped rope all day long. We'd stand in line just to jump rope if Estella was swinging that rope. The other thing that she did was she brought crafts to the park, and you could take money. You could take 10 cents, 15 cents, a quarter, and make different things. We made potholders. We made lanyards. We made bracelets. And you would plan for days exactly what you were going to do. And if you were going to put your initial in your bracelet, if you were going to put your boyfriend's initials in your bracelet, or just exactly what you were going to do. But we all loved to make the crafts that Miss Stella brought for us. And she lived in Silver Circle. She lived a good long while and was just really respected by everybody for taking care of their kids, mainly, I think. They had, for this little small of a town, they had four churches. Bemis Baptist Church was the largest, and that's where my family and I attended church. The Methodist Church is the oldest, and it's on the historical registry. It is right here. And there was a Bemis Elementary School right behind it. They joined, the lots joined. And I attended the elementary school from grades 1 through 4. And then in fifth grade, we moved to the J.B. Young Elementary School. But I'm jumping around just a little bit. But here was the Bemis Baptist Church. Now, it did not look like that at first. It was called Heron Chapel. It was much smaller. They tore it down and started building part of this. But the Methodist Church looks just like that today. And it's a wonderful, wonderful building. My aunt and uncle attended church there, and their children were married there. And I love to go and visit because the beams are all open and wonderful. It is a great place. And I hope that someday that your classes might could go visit the Methodist Church. It's very, very special. In the elementary school behind the Methodist Church, now we were told we were never to go on the lot of the church. That was forbidden. And so my girlfriends and I, two others, Barbara and Joanne, and I would sneak over to the church because, you know, it was forbidden. And there was a little porch right here on the side that was covered. And we could run in there and get down like this and hide from the teacher. And we did that many times when it was at recess time. At lunchtime, there was no cafeteria in the building of the Bemis Elementary School. We had to go across the street. It was kind of like a house that was a long house. And we would go across the street. So if it was raining or yucky or muddy or whatever, you went anyway because that's where you had your food. You didn't take your lunch in those days. And they expected you to eat everything on your plate. You were served a certain plate. And they expected you to eat it all. The teacher would come by to see. Well, I hated beets, still hate beets to this day. And so on beet day, I would always sit next to Joanne. And I would do anything. I'd do her math homework. I would do whatever I had to get her to eat my beets. And to this day, I see her and I remember that she ate beets for me. So I'm very appreciative for Joanne. And the skating rink. Well, that was, I'll talk about that later. If I forget about the skating rink, please remind me because that was in the YMCA and that was built a little bit later after Mr. Bemis died. They did not have a bank here, and so people would travel 2 miles on a dirt road into Jackson to bank if they wanted to. They did not have ready-made clothes for sale in the town of Bemis. They only had dry goods, which meant fabrics for you to make your clothes. So if you wanted to bank, or to buy ready-made clothes and shoes or purses, you would have to go into town, into Jackson. My clothes were made by my mother and my grandmother, and they would go to the general store in Bemis. It's general store. The building is still there, and I still remember going in. The floors were wooden, and they creaked when you walked on them. And so if there was no salesperson close, as soon as you stepped foot in the building, they could hear you walk because it creaked so. But my mother and grandmother would go and they would buy their patterns and they would buy their fabrics for the season and make our clothes. I have an older sister. I want to emphasize that. I have an older sister. It's Miss Bruhn. She teaches here. And I usually had to wear her hand-me-downs because I was the younger sister. And I was always thrilled when I got something made just for me to wear. It was very, very special. But they made our coats, our winter coats, our hats, and everything. And they were very good seamstresses. We thought we were well-dressed and really cool, whatever they put on us. All my dresses had sashes that you tied in the back, and I remember at recess I always got one of my sashes torn out. I went home with my clothes ripped, I think, every day, my mother said. So, anyway, when Mr. Bemis died, a man by the name of J.B. Young took over the duties of supervising all of the activities of this little small model town of Bemis. Each mill worker received his pay weekly on Friday in a little brown envelope. Mother said that they were very small. She didn't know how they got money in those. But my uncle was the paymaster for Bemis, and he worked in the office. And there were different ladies who took care of different costs. Your groceries were taken out, your medical bills were taken out, your coal, all the homes were heated with coal. Every house in Silver Circle had three bedrooms and one bath, and each bedroom had a fireplace because that's how in the living area, because that's how the houses were heated, and you bought coal from Bemis. And so all of this was taken out of the money. Everybody was paid in cash on Friday in this little brown envelope. So because it was a lot of money in those days, an armored car, and she remembered this, would drive my uncle from the bank with the money to the mill and go with him inside the building until he had it safely inside and start to disperse all of that. I don't know, any of you probably have never recognized, on the corner there across from the mill and across from the museum, I want you to look if you go by there, there's a lot, there's not a building on it, there's nothing on it. And the reason is there's a tunnel underneath that. From the mill over to the museum or over to the movie, and I don't know why in the world they dug a tunnel and had it connected from the mill to the movie theater at that time. But nothing can be built on that spot because it would crush the tunnel. So I wonder if it's still open, if it's open today, if you could actually go under the tunnel. I'm not sure, but that's an interesting thing. Maybe we can find out. I don't know if it was built for security or safety, or I'm not real sure, but I think it's cool. They had a water tower that had Bemis on it, and that supplied all of the water. I just think it's the neatest thing that this little one town had everything that was needed to exist and live and have a good life. They had electricians and plumbers. If something happened at your home, you would call the office or go by and see and tell them what you wanted and what was happening, and they would send someone, and it was free. I mean, there was no charge for electricians and no charge for the plumbers, and that was not on your bill. You did pay for your coal to heat your house, but they had a street department that kept the streets clean and the trees clipped over the streets, and I thought it was wonderful. My grandfather, Gary, my mother's father, was in charge of all the sports activities in Bemis. He played baseball, and my uncle played basketball. And my grandfather was also responsible for running the movie reel on Saturday night with black and white movies. And we were always excited if there was a cartoon. And remember how much it cost to get into the movies?
5 cents.
Now, when Mr. J.D. Young came and started supervising, he built the YMCA, and that's where there was a skating rink. Now, that building has been torn down now, sadly, but it was a Y, and over there on the second level of the Y, we had our kindergarten class, where I went to kindergarten, and we also had our Brownie Scout and Girl Scout troop meetings up there. And adjacent to the Y was the skating rink. Now, the men played at the Y. They shot pool, and they played cards and dominoes and checkers and that sort of thing. I couldn't wait to be old enough to go skating. And finally, my mom let me go skating. It was 10 cents on Saturday afternoon. But I wanted to be big enough to go on Saturday night because that's when all the really cool people went. So my sister, being older, she had to drag me along on Saturday night. I'm sure that cramped her style, but she dragged me along, and it cost 20 cents on Saturday night, so I had to kind of save my allowance to be able to go. But the next thing that I wanted to save for was the skates, because they had the clamp-on metal skates that they rented to you to skate, and, you know, they were horrible. And I asked for a pair of my own white leather skates that laced up for Christmas and got those. And we tied them in a knot and slung them over our shoulder, and we were just so special and so cool when we went in the skating rink with our own skates. And we liked to skate in the blue light special. If a boy asked you to skate, then that was very special to be able to skate with him in the blue light. Some of the streets of Bemis were named after states: Missouri, Massachusetts, Tennessee. Some were named after the alphabet: A Street, B Street, C Street, and then numbers: 2nd Street, 3rd, 4th, 5th, and 6th Street. Mr. Moss and later Mr. Young, when he came, were the only people who lived in the second story house. And it was in the left back corner of the community, and nobody else had a two-story house. And we always would drive by and say, oh, what a beautiful big house that was. The last section to be built in Bemis was called Newtown because it was the newest section. And it is the section that just backs up to our school right here. Those streets right there, and that was called Newtown. I had a lot of friends who lived in Newtown that I went to high school with. Mr. J.B. Young built a high school right here on this lot, and it was called J.B. Young High School, and that's where my mother graduated from J.B. Young. And later it was turned into an elementary school, and I attended grades 5th, 6th, 7th, and 8th here before I went on to Southside. The high school basketball team, their colors were red and white, mainly red, and their mascot was a cat. And this is Bemis. This is Bemis, not Southside Hawks, Hawks and Hawkettes. I was a Hawk and Hawkette, but first I was a cat. And it was, here is the cat coming out of the bag, and it was always pictured like this because this was the bag made at the Bemis Mill, so we were Bemis cats, and it was always depicted this way, but that was because of the bag. You know, don't let the cat out of the bag, but they were the cats. And it was used on many things. This logo right here was used on not just ball caps and their uniforms, but many things in the little community. Now, Christmas was a very special time in this little town. A few days before Christmas, families would go out into the woods located right next to the little town, and they would cut down their own fresh cedar tree and take it home to decorate. And they decorated with popcorn, strings of popcorn, and strings of cranberries. And my mother made something neat. I had to call her last night and said, what was that you used? I remember her mixing up something that was white, and she said it was ivory snow flakes. Now, the flakes are very, very thick, tissue thin, and you could see through them. And they were little tiny squares, and she would put them in a bowl, and she would add water, and then she would use a mixer. But now these ivory snowflakes were actually a detergent that she would wash clothes with. But at this time, she would make it very thick, and then she would take her hands, dip them into that solution there of the thick white, and would rake it down the stems of the tree so it looked like it was just loaded with snow. And it would smell wonderful and looked wonderful, but her hands were absolutely raw. It just tore your hands up, and I didn't know why she'd want to do it, but she did love the way it looked, I guess. Of course, strings of lights were added later to the trees. Christmas Eve, all businesses were closed. They wanted all of the families to spend Christmas together and have their families be together. Christmas dinner, my mother said, was always the same, and we do it to this day. We always have at her house, we make the same foods every year. When she was growing up, dinner was chicken and dressing, green beans, sweet potatoes, corn, macaroni and cheese. Now, that was your main meal. We have much of that today at her home. Fresh coconut cake, where you grate your own coconut. It didn't come in a bag or a can. Pecan pie, chocolate pie, and, of course, some congealed salad. So it was a very special time, and it sounds wonderful to me. I thought another really unique thing was about this little town. There were three families that had 13 children. 13 children. Husband and wife had 13 children. I still can't wrap my mind around that one. But they grew up, and they grew up in the streets, and they grew up in the towns and in the buildings here. And I went to school with them. I cheered with them, went to class with them, and they were the Fishers, and they were the Patricks, and they were the Robinsons. Margie Patrick Robinson lives across the street from me today where I live in Jackson. And I see her sister that I cheered on the cheerleading team with often. And the Fishers were everywhere. Now, once a year in May, there's a reunion in Bemis. And people come from all over the United States back to see each other because there's something about the community of Bemis that has stayed with them and lived with them. So they come back and visit. They bring their trailers. Some of them camp out, and some of them bring their trailers and park in different places in Bemis. But it's a very special time. They have a special music, night of music, and dinner on the ground. And that's the second weekend in May, so if anybody wants to come and see all of that, I think it's great. Now, to keep this area alive, Bemis has a historical society that meets on the second Tuesday of every month. And hats off to them for doing that, for wanting to keep the specialness of Bemis still alive and to improve the museum. And they, of course, take donations and try to get more memorabilia and try to fight anything being torn down. Once Mr. Young died and they stopped making so much cloth, and you know, times kind of got bad, and they were ready to sell the mill, and they decided that they probably needed to sell the houses, and so they offered the houses for sale at that time to anyone that wasn't in the city of Bemis or employed here. And at that time, the people that were employed by the mill were able to buy their home at a very reasonable price. And that was the point where people started to paint the houses different colors. But when the town was early on, each house was painted only white, but it was freshly painted once every 5 years. And they had a painting building, and they had painters. One of my best friends in my class, Daddy, was the foreman of the painters. And somebody kept up with, you know, they would start at one end and go all around all the streets painting the entire house. And I'm sure by the time they got all of them painted, it was time to start over again with the house where you first started. So I thought that was a neat thing about it, too. I think I've covered just about everything that my mother and I could remember. But I'm happy to take questions. And if I don't know, I want you to know that I was a very young little girl when all this was going on. Wasn't I, Stacy? Yes.
What was your favorite childhood memory?
Favorite childhood memory? Probably was going to my uncle's house where everybody in my family, he had five brothers and sisters, and all of their spouses and all of their children. And we would go there and have breakfast on Christmas Day and get to take one toy that we loved. And then one of my cousins, he was kind of mean, and he would catch a rabbit, and we'd chase the rabbit up and down the hall.
How did Mr. Bemis come up with the idea about having the perfect community?
You know, I don't know. I just think that was something that he thought would be a wonderful idea, and he wanted to try and see if he could make it work with everything contained in this one little area. And I thought it was marvelous. Oh, we had a post office. I don't know. Did I even mention that?
Yes.
The post office is here today, and I think they have tried to close it several times. And I remember going to the post office. It's very, very tiny. It seems like it's no wider than that table right there. But at one time, the drugstore and the dry cleaners, my grandfather went from being a foreman at the mill to opening his own dry cleaners, and we called it the Patton Block, and I don't know why the name, but it was across from the Baptist Church, and it had the dry cleaners, and it had a drugstore and a little cafe and several other, I'm not sure what the other, can't remember what they were, but I remember going there and running up and down that sidewalk, riding my bicycle up and down the sidewalk. But my mother used to go and help at the drugstore. But he wanted to see if he could get everything that you needed to exist, and I think he did. And he took care of all the needs and more.
What was school like?
Well, when I went to school, it was much like what you're doing now, except we had a desk that were single desk with your chair and everything attached to it. It wasn't much different from what it is now.
What is your tip?
Please, I'm not that old.
What was your typical view when you opened your door to go to school? What was the first thing that you would see?
I think my mother's saying, come on, hurry up, get in the car. No, we rode the bus, and the bus was probably city block today for me from my house to the corner where the stop sign was. And she would get me up, and, you know, when I walked out, I mean, I just saw the sidewalk and the road, and I would walk down the road and get on the bus. And it was a real treat if my mother was able to leave work and come to pick me up. I do remember that. I didn't have to ride the bus because I'd much rather ride in the car with her.
Do you think that Mr. Bemis established a real utopian community?
I do. I think everything was here, and I think people loved being here and respected each other and their property, and I think they, for most part, got along well. Anybody else have any questions? Is he doing all the questions? Are you supposed to do them all? All right.
Is when you were putting together at school, what was some stuff that you would do after you went to school? I mean, you went to the park.
Well, the park was only in the summer. Miss Stella was teaching kindergarten, so after a day of kindergarten, she didn't, you know, I'm sure feel like going to the park. But that was open only in the summer. It had a wire fence around it, so, and it was padlocked, so you couldn't get in unless Miss Stella was the only one that I knew that had the key. I'm sure someone had.
How long have you been living in Bemis?
Since 1968.
And you were born in Bemis?
I wasn't born in Bemis. I came to Bemis when I was 17.
Okay. And you've been living there ever since? Okay. Do you have any interesting childhood stories about living in Bemis?
Yes. When I came to Bemis, Bemis was a real great unique community.
Mm-hmm.
And we had the Bemis Park, we had the Bemis Pond, and most of these icons we have on the wall here in Bemis Park, and those are the things that we enjoy.
Mm-hmm.
Bemis, the drugstore where we could go and get soda and shakes and things, and the 60s, that was the going thing. We even had a skate ring in Bemis, a YMCA. So it was just a great place to work. I mean, to be a child and grow up even as a teenager.
What are your thoughts on the community center?
The community center is a vision of mine to take the old Bemis school and convert it into a Bemis community center. It's a historic building, and we've learned that it's the oldest school building left in the Bemis community. The other schools are torn down or destroyed in some other way. It's the oldest building standing, and we are going to preserve the building and let it be a historic site where we put historic items in it where children and people come by and, you know, just see what it used to be in that school and then in the Bemis community.
And who all is helping you to restore?
We have a board of directors made up of several people, and Mr. Billy King, Mr. Joel Jackson, and Mr. Fisher are men that have some connections with historic preservation. TNSU College is going to help us as well to do some restoring of that.
Okay. Seems like you're getting a lot of help.
Yeah.
A lot of people believe in what you're going to do.
That's right.
Did you know anybody, did you move here with your family when you moved to Bemis originally?
Well, I moved to Bemis. I got married and moved to Bemis.
Okay. And did you live in this area?
Yes, I still live in Bemis.
Oh, okay.
I live down on Butler Street in Bemis.
Okay.
Across from the community center.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
That's all the questions I have.
Okay. Well, I really appreciate you concerned about the community asking questions.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.